You're listening to the DolphinsTalk.com podcast network.
You're listening to DolphinsTalk.com Daily, the most listened to daily Miami Dolphins podcast on the internet. Come on, Dolphins fans. Time to fins up.
Miami's got the Dolphins, the greatest football team. We take the ball from goal to goal like no one's ever seen. We're in the air.
Good morning, Miami Dolphins fans. How are you today? And thank you for listening to DolphinsTalk.com Daily on this Thursday, August the 27th. I am your host, Mike. Joining me on the show tonight is Ian Biggie from right here at DolphinsTalk.com. How you doing, Ian?
Hey, buddy. Fins up, man. Today, 17 days until Miami Dolphins football.
Thank the Lord. It can't come soon enough. And we got a great show today. After I chat here a bit with Ian, I will be joined on this podcast by Jim Florentine, who is a diehard Miami Dolphins super fan. You know him from his podcast over at Barstool Sports. Obviously, all of his shows on Comedy Central, and I'm sure you've seen him at a comedy club near you in the recent years as he travels the whole world to do his comedy. Jim is a diehard fan of the Dolphins, and, you know, he listens to our podcast and is a big fan of our show, so always a treat to have him on. But first, E, we got to talk about some news here in the world of the Miami Dolphins. 13,000 fans in the stadium to at least start the year, hopefully more over time. And when I heard that news, as I said on the podcast yesterday, the first person I thought of was you, and I was so happy for you and your family, as I know how much you enjoy heading to those games. And it sounds like you made the cut, which is good. Tell me about the process. How did it work out? It sounds like you got an email on Monday and on Tuesday. Just walk everyone through, how it sort of played out.
Yeah. So I was very, very happy hearing the news on Monday morning. I forget who it was that broke the news, but then like a few minutes later, Andy Slater made the official breaking news. And then a few minutes later, it came out from the Dolphins organization. I immediately checked my email and found that I was being instructed what to do next. So I basically went to the website that they recommended, and we really had two options. One option was to go ahead and go to these games and say you want to go, you want to opt in. And the second option was to opt out, which was to basically take the money that you've already paid this year and apply it towards the 2021 season. And I think there may have been another option to get the to get a full refund. I just didn't look down that far after.
Exactly.
After I saw the first one, I said, that's the one I'm doing. So I went to the site and I selected it right away. I did call a couple of different ticket reps that I have a relationship with just to find out some other questions and see some things. I think a big question right now is for non-season ticket holders. They want to know if they're going to be able to buy some tickets to the game. And from what I have found out so far, these season ticket holders, there may be an opportunity where they're not going to be able to go to a game. So there are not restrictions as of right now. However, Ticketmaster is going to look at some things from what I understand, from what I was told, because if you have six seats within your pod, within your season ticket account, you don't want to sell three tickets to one set of family and then the other three tickets to another set of individuals, because it really defeats the purpose of what the Hard Rock Stadium is trying to do as far as keeping people away from others. So I think there's going to be some details coming out about that. But then yesterday, after I did speak to another ticket representative, I did receive the email that said, I will have an opportunity come next Tuesday to pick my new seats. And that's going to be a really interesting process, because the way that the stadium is going to be set up is that there are only going to be certain seats available for season ticket holders to be able to select. And chances are they could be, I'd say the better chances are they're not going to be the seats that you normally sit in. I know that the first couple of rows from the bottom of the field are not going to be available. So you have to imagine those season ticket holders are going to try and find something a little bit higher. You know, plus there's obviously the limited number of individuals that will be allowed into the stadium. So next Tuesday, and what's going to happen is based on your tenure, based on your seniority, is how you're going to be able to select your tickets. And the good thing is this, they said, if you find tickets that are usually a little more expensive than the ones you normally have, you can pay the difference, or vice versa. If you end up, you know, and you're normally in the 100 level, but you want to go in the 300 level, you could get a refund for the difference because it might be less expensive go from 100 to 300. Nice. So it is actually a very nice program. You know, and Mike, this is, you know, this whole thing is a little taboo to talk about. And I think that, you know, you do have some folks out there that are very concerned and that they're very health conscious, and, you know, and they don't want large crowds. And, you know, I listened intently to what Tom Garfinkel had to say and some of the things that they're doing around the stadium to really avoid close contact with individuals. And it is significant. You know, when you talk about the fact, first of all, that it is an outdoor stadium, so you've got the outdoor breeze flowing throughout the stadium. You know, there's a huge difference between that and going even to your grocery store or walking into a restaurant, because it's closed doors. You know, your air conditioning is filtering usually the same air. So there's that. The other thing is, and I thought through this, because of what they're doing with the gates and how you have to go in at a designated time, there's not going to be thousands of people all going in at the same time. You're not going to really be with a large group of people when you're going in. They've got new metal detectors that will allow it so that you do not need to, like, take the stuff out of your pocket and put it on a table like you've had to do. Basically, no one's going to have to touch your stuff, which, yeah, I think is really important. And then going to your seats, you know, you're going to be distanced away from somebody else. You do have to wear a mask the entire time you're there, except for when you're eating or drinking. And you do have to be conscious about where you're doing that, obviously. But when you're at your seats, you can order your food from one of the vendors downstairs, and they will have it ready for you. So it's kind of like pickup at the restaurants nowadays. You go downstairs, you say, my name is Ian Big E, and I'm here to pick up my soda and whatever else. They get it for you, you go back up. So there should be no lines to be able to eat at, you know, at Hard Rock, which is great. There's not going to be smoking allowed, so you won't have people just hanging around smoking without their masks on. And I think that was something they thought of too. And lastly that I'll mention is that, you know, the bathrooms, they have changed it so that you do not have to touch the faucets anymore. And some other stuff too, obviously. Everything is going to be touchless within the bathroom for the men and the women. So when you think about it, I don't see an opportunity where I'm going to be very close to other people. I'm going to be outdoors, and I'm going to try and get in the upper level. There's going to be that breeze. I'm going to be wearing the mask. I know some people complain it's so hot outside. What, you know, how are you going to wear a mask?
Because
and that's the thing.
You know, the rules up front. If you don't want to wear a mask for however many hours you're there, don't go. Because that's the thing. Nobody is forcing anyone to go. For the people who want to go, they're going to wear the mask. Or, you know, so I think people just have to understand there's rules this year. And it's not going to be the same. It's going to be a little different. But the rules, like you're sort of going through, they all make sense. No paper towels. Good. No, you know, it's going to be automatic flush in the bathroom, automatic water. Things are going to turn on and off there with the faucet. You can't pay for anything in cash. You got to have a card. So for some people, if you want to go there and pay for this or pay for food or buy a hat or buy a jersey, you better show up with some sort of piece of plastic, because they won't take your cash. No paper. When you walk in the stadium, it's all going to have to be on your phone or an app where you sit and all that stuff. So it makes a lot of sense.
It does. And I'm just excited because we're going to be able, you know, I will do my best to document everything for the Dolphins fans. And I know a lot of people on Twitter are excited. They're happy for me because they know that I've gone to every game. And I have had some people approach me and ask me if I'd sell any tickets. And I tell them, I haven't missed a game, preseason or regular season game, in the last 8 years. And I don't plan on doing it this year if I can't, you know, if I can help it. So I'm excited about it. Again, 18 days until the home opener, but the game against the Patriots. And then the week after that is with the Bills. Here's the other thing that they said, you know, 4 weeks down the road, 8 weeks down the road, things may improve to the point where the organization or Hard Rock Stadium feels like they can add more than 13,000 fans in the stands. So, you know, they didn't say that this is set in stone how it's going to be the entire season.
It's a fluid situation.
It is a very fluid situation. I like that. You know, it gives people some hope. I was communicating with someone today who's already bought her tickets, you know, coming down from Washington with a group of people. family members to try and go to a game, and their tickets got revoked. So she's like, what am I going to do? And I said, well, you can look to see once tickets are available after next Tuesday, because that's when people are going to know what their seat assignments are. But then you can also just keep checking and see if those, you know, see if they start allowing more people into the stadium. So I think it's all for good.
Yeah. And for those people who might not be, you know, like you, who have season tickets, just pick up the phone and call the Dolphins, call Hard Rock Stadium, and ask them. They are truly the nicest people in the world and the easiest people to work with. They will answer your questions, and if they can help you, trust me, they will. They will accommodate you if they can. Now, if they can't for some reason, it's something that's probably out of their hands, so be nice to them. But if they can help you, trust me, they will. They don't want to turn people away. They want to make fans for life, and they want to make people happy. That's their job. So, look, it's only 13,000 now. Like you said, that number could go up. On the flip side, it could also go down. Sure. So you got to. Everyone has to follow the rules. I think the rules they put in place are very fair and very reasonable. You can't ask for anything more than you have to walk into this gate at this time. If you want food, you have to pay with a card. There's going to be no paper seat tickets. You have to get it on your. Everything they're doing is reasonable to me. There's not something on that list where I go, that's a bit extreme. Not one thing. And yes, you got to wear a mask. So if you don't want to wear a mask, just don't go. Let someone else go, because that's the rule. But I think it's fair. I think it's good. And, you know, I was happy to see that. I was happy for you. Just that, you know, some people will be there in attendance. I also think, too, it'll be interesting. Obviously, there's a lot of room to space these people out. There's a lot of room. It's a huge stadium.
Yep.
And it's a small number that will be in this huge stadium. I wonder, though, if they try to sneak, not sneak's a bad word, try to have the majority of the 13,000 sort of be in that lower bowl, 100, 200 level, just because on TV that's more visually appealing. So yeah, I would try to think they might sneak more down there just so it doesn't look like it's an empty stadium. But sure, they're going to have some people up top too, because you got to space everyone out in a safe manner. But I would think they would probably want to put as many lower as they could.
Good point. You know, I think that's important, but I also think, you know, if you cut it in half, it's about 30,000 in the lower half, maybe 25,000. If you're putting 13 in there, then you're saying maybe one person every other seat. I don't know if the math works out that way. So I think that's why they're going to spread it out. But I'm excited about it. I think that there's, my next step, which is next Tuesday, is going to be really interesting to see what seats are available when I go select. And honestly, I'm happy where I'm sitting right now. Yeah. 50-yard line, as high up as you can go on the home side with a wall to my back. If there's anything available along that row, I'm going to be selecting those seats because I like it. I love the fact that I can stand up. You know, the last thing I'm going to say about this is that while we're at the stadium, it really ends up being the responsibility of every single person that's at that stadium to do the right thing, to keep their mask on. You know, if I happen to notice that somebody's eating food, you know, maybe they have their mask off, or maybe they're drinking and they have their mask off, I'm going to do what I can to kind of stay away from that person. Yeah. You know, just not to say that I think that they're sick, but I'd rather be safe than sorry. You know, so, and that's going to happen. But I think it's up to each of us to kind of have that mindset to say, yeah, this might be happening. You know, let's make sure that we each do what we can to keep this a safe environment and be able to continue coming back.
Yeah, absolutely. It's always up to personal responsibility with people. And hopefully, you know, everyone does follow. Look, you're going there to have a good time. Everyone just wants to go there, have a good time. Yes, you want to see your team win. But win or lose, you don't want to get sick of the process. This is no joke, this virus. I know some people do think it's a joke. Trust me, it's no joke. Let's talk about some stuff on the field, though.
Yep.
With the quarterbacks. Obviously, Fitzpatrick's the week one starter. That goes without saying. It seems like this week, though, the second week of practices, that Tua Tagovailoa has sort of separated himself a little bit here from Josh Rosen and is sort of removing all doubt on who's going to be the number two quarterback. What are your thoughts on that?
I will tell you something that was very encouraging to me, and I think it happened yesterday, and it may have been today, but Tua ran an 18-yard run during practice, and it was one of those situations where it was supposed to be a throw, but then he found the opportunity to be able to run, And he was able to show that he wasn't afraid to make that run. Now, when there's that he's wearing that red jersey right now. You know, wearing that red jersey means you're not going to get tackled. You're not going to get hit. So, you know, that mindset might be that, hey, I'm going to run. No one's going to hit me. Maybe when the red jersey is off, I think scrimmage is coming up this coming Saturday as a possibility. Who knows yet? I heard that through the news today. But once that jersey goes off, is he still going to be that person that takes off running? Because that's really a big part of his game, and it has been a big part of his game. So I still think those maybe the first two games, I think you're still going to see Josh Rosen as the number two quarterback. Or, and this may be crazy, may not be crazy, maybe they have three quarterbacks dressed. You know, it's not unheard of. It's not necessary. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So you may have three quarterbacks dressed. And the purpose for that is if the Dolphins are up, you know, significantly, which I'm going to be very optimistic and say they will against the Patriots the first week, maybe you give Tua an opportunity to get behind a real line, a live line, you know, just to get him used to get the juices flowing. Basically like a preseason game, right? You get when you're up so much, they're going to put their backups in, you're going to put your backups in, you know, but you still want Josh Rosen there because if Fitzpatrick goes down for one reason or another, you've got Rosen that can take the reins and you don't have to push Tua into that just yet. But it was encouraging to me because it sounded like everything's starting to click for Tua. And I think as each week goes by, you're going to hear a little bit more better about him. And I'm just glad that first week is over because after the first week, the sky was falling.
Oh my God.
We had the worst draft in the history of the NFL. You know, he's going to be a bust after one week of practice.
We're talking about practice, folks. As I always say, we're talking about practice at the end of the day. People are reading too much into that stuff. Yes, it matters and stuff. But you got to take everything with a grain of salt because it's practice. And, you know, this kid's going to be fine. When he sees the field, who knows? Hopefully we get to see him this year at some point. But I would, you know, don't overreact to stuff that happens in practice because, you know, you're lining up against the same guy day after day, week after week. There's only so much you can do after a while. And Tua's going to be fine. He's the last guy right now I am worried about. With the offensive line, we always talk about the young rookies, and it seems like right now two of those young rookies are sort of making a name for themselves and sort of playing themselves into the starting lineup, and that would be Austin Jackson at left tackle, who doesn't have a lot of competition there, but the fact he's winning is good. You know, if he was losing this battle, we'd have reason to be nervous, but he's not. The fact he's playing well, and Solomon Kinley from Georgia is, I guess, turning a lot of heads at right guard. So, you know, we've been sort of talking about this a lot here the past month or so, how many rookies will start. I think right now it's safe to say that we're going to see two start on this offensive line come week one. And I think both of them have been well-earned from all the reports. Obviously I'm not there. You're not there. From everything we're hearing from the people who are there, they're both out there playing well enough to warrant being in the starting lineup. What are your thoughts on that?
I love the fact that we have a fourth round draft pick that could potentially be starting on the offensive line and be really good at it. You know, I know what happened this week with Curtis Weaver. A lot of people are, you know, sad and they're kind of questioning what you got from, you know, from Greer and from Flores for this draft out of one pick, right?
Yeah, I know.
But here you're looking at a fourth rounder that could potentially start from day one, which I love. However, too, you have to look at Robert Hunt because he was picked early, right, in the second round, and he's not there yet. I mean, we're not waving our hands up saying that he's not going to be there, but at this point, he's not there, and I think there's definitely some room to grow. And I know you mentioned it on your podcast yesterday. What schools these guys came from really helped to build their pedigree to prepare them or not prepare them for the National Football League. You know, and Robert coming from Louisiana, a smaller school than Solomon Kinley, who's coming from Georgia, you can see that. You can see that based on what they're doing right now in the first couple of weeks of practice.
Yeah, and with Hunt also, you know, he's trying to learn two positions. You know, trying to learn right tackle and right guard coming from, you know, the Sun Belt, which again, nothing against the Sun Belt. There's been a lot of good players that come from the Sun Belt Conference, but how many guys have sort of come from that conference and jumped into the action week one right off the bat, especially with no type of mini camps, no preseason. It might take him longer. Once again, that doesn't mean the pick's a bust. Don't everybody flip out on Robert Hunt thinking it was a bad pick. We might not see him be the guy we think he is until 2021. And that's okay. That's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. But Solomon Kinley coming from the SEC, this for him is a, you know, yes, it's a jump up in class, but it's a smaller jump. It's like a skip. Or for someone like Hunt, right. It's a giant right. leap. It's like the long jump. And it's going to be more of a learning curve for him. But, you know, Solomon Kinley from the SEC, Austin Jackson from the Pac-12, not a surprise those guys are sort of picking things up a little faster because who they play against each week are guys who are also NFL-ready for the most part. So, yes, promising on the offensive line. I think, you know, as we sit here now on, what are we, August 27th, I guess. Yes, August 27th. The offensive line probably looks like Jesse Davis, Solomon Kinley, Ted Karras, Eric Flowers, Austin Jackson. You know, ready to go to war with those guys up front. Big improvement over last year. Yes, there's a couple young guys. They'll have their lumps. They'll probably get beat a few times. But you know what? That's what you have to go through when you're playing young guys on the offensive line. And I think the risk is worth the reward there.
What a difference a season makes. That's all I'm going
to
say.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And when it comes to Weaver, you know, I saw one guy on Twitter. He actually bought a Curtis Weaver Miami Dolphins jersey.
Wow.
You know, and I did send a tweet, and I didn't mean it in a insulting way, but what were you thinking? I mean, a fifth-round pick. You went out and bought a jersey that quick. God bless you. That's a diehard fan, but I think fans are a little too up in arms about Weaver. If they thought there was something there with this kid, and I know it was just 1 week of practice that they saw him in, if they saw something or really thought they had something, they would have found a way to hold on to him. That many draft picks, you're not going to hit on them all. This kid
exactly.
was picked. He was picked in round 5 for a reason, folks. Okay, there's a reason he went in round 5, and every team passed on him, you know, once, twice, three times, four. There's a reason. Yes, I know everyone loved that pick when it was made, but and once again, hindsight's 2020. If in 3 years, Ian, you and me are sitting here on this podcast on a Wednesday night recording, and Weaver is just put up, you know, 3 years in a row where he's getting sacks left and right, great player, we can rip Chris Greer, if he still has a job at that point, up one side, down the other. But I'm not thinking that day's going to happen. And, you know, I think this is going to be an afterthought here real quick. I think people made far too much out of the Weaver move.
I first of all, I do feel bad for the guy.
Yeah, I feel bad for him, too. He got hurt. Badly.
He got hurt, you know, and he got released by his team. And fortunately for him, you know, another team saw enough in really, they saw enough in him in college because they have no idea really how he looked like in training camp. But what I can say, and Safi Dean actually spoke this afternoon, he was on the Hawk and Crowder show, and he was talking about how they noticed something in Zoom meetings. There was something there that they didn't like in Zoom meetings. And then when it came to training camp, he just wasn't making an impact. You never heard of him doing anything good. You never really heard of him doing anything bad. You don't really even know if he got a chance to be on the field or if he was on the field, if he made an impact, because you never heard his name. You know, you heard all these other rookies being mentioned for good and for bad. And now you're hearing a lot for the good, especially from many of these rookies right now. But you never hear anything. So that's why I think for the coach to make that decision, now he's going to be political, Coach Flores, when answering questions about it, because it's the right thing to do. You're never going to say he just didn't work out. You know, yeah. He said we were hoping, right, that he'd clear waivers, we put him on IR. I think also part of that is because you don't, as a coach, you don't ever really want to give up on somebody. You know, you think that you'll have an opportunity to change this guy, but there's something there that Flores convinced Greer and said, this isn't going to be right for me. This person is not going to fit for our long-term plans. And that's why he took the risk and let him go to the Browns. So.
And you mentioned something might happen there with Zoom meetings or something like that. People have to understand, in college, these guys are also in class. They have only so many hours with their staff and stuff. to prepare. When you go to the NFL, it is a job. And they are watching you every step of the way. They watch what time you show up for a meeting. They watch if you're paying attention to a meeting. They watch if you're taking notes. Is he taking enough notes? Why isn't he writing more notes? What's going on? They are watching every little move you make. And if they think, and I don't know this to be the case, so I don't want to say this about the kid. I don't know. If they think he wasn't putting in enough work off the field, if he came to camp out of shape at the wrong weight, stuff we wouldn't know about, you know, that would play a factor into this. Then he goes on the field. He isn't making the impact they thought he would. Then he gets hurt. They're like, you know what? We could just put him on IR, pay him, and wait till next year. Or they could be like, why pay him now? Let's just put him on waivers. If someone takes him, we're not going to be crying about it type of deal. Sure, we want him back, but if he's gone, eh. So there's a lot that goes into this. Trust me. They didn't just willy-nilly put him on IR or put him on waivers and say, maybe he comes back, maybe he doesn't. Let's wait and see. There was, I'm sure, a lot of people involved in a lot of phone calls because he was a fifth-round pick. I know it's not the highest round, but it also was a fifth-round pick. I'm sure they had a lot of conversations about this, and I'm not going to flip out over a fifth-round pick not making a team. Honestly, it's just – I can't. I just can't. I can't.
I agree. I completely agree with you. It's just not worth – it's not worth us second-guessing our coach, the coach that – that did amazing things with some lower talented players last season, you know, and now has his second draft class. I think, you know, we have been so used to stringing players along for so many years that didn't fit. And we kept saying, well, we're going to coach him up. We're going to get him there. And then just never worked. A lot of the players that were on the Dolphins, you know, many of them that just we hung on to for too long, they never really made an impact in the National Football League. So if you had a coach that maybe said after one season not working, you know, we're not gonna keep you around because you're just not there where we need you to be at the National Football League level. I wonder how different things could have been, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So okay, here's what we're gonna do. Right now I'm gonna take a quick break, and after the break, we're gonna be joined by Jim Florentine, stand-up comic, Miami Dolphins, diehard super fan. We've had him on the podcast a number of times. I had a chance to talk with him and get his thoughts on the upcoming 2020 season, get his thoughts on everything happening with the Dolphins, talk to him about how, you know, his life here, sort of as a road comic in this COVID world, how that's sort of what's happening there and a bunch of things. You know, Jim has been on our podcast many, many times. He's a big fan of our website and a big supporter of ours, which I can't thank him enough for that. But, you know, he's a diehard fan. He diehard as they come of the Miami Dolphins. He travels down to Miami once or twice a year to watch games. What he does, he told me to sign the podcast last year when I had him on. He will schedule his comedy club dates around the Miami Dolphins schedule. So if they're in Miami week 4 on a Sunday, you know, he will try to find a venue in Fort Lauderdale, Hollywood, somewhere down there to work on a Friday and Saturday. And then boom, he's in town already for Sunday. He can go to the game. So he's as a diehard fan as they come. So
it's good to hear that I'm not the only one that changes my life when the Dolphins schedule comes out. That's good to hear.
Absolutely not. No, all fans of the Dolphins, they all change their schedule because, you know, those Sundays are, you know, and there's so few of them. They're so important, I think, to diehard fans like you, like Jim, like myself. We value those Sundays so much because it does go by in the blink of an eye. And NFL season really does go flying by because there's only 17 weeks, 16 games, not counting the playoffs because we haven't been in the playoffs in a while. But it's just, So first some plugs. Everyone, be sure to follow Ian Biggie on Twitter at Ian693. And right now I'm going to take a quick break. And after the break, we'll be joined by Miami Dolphins superfan Jim Florentine.
Miami Dolphins fans, be sure to purchase the new book, 100 Things Dolphins Fans Should Know and Do Before They Die, at DolphinsTalk.com. Use the promo code DolphinsTalk, all one word, between now and November 1st to save 25% off the price. Written by Armando Salguero of the Miami Herald, and with a foreword written by NFL Hall of Famer and Miami Dolphins legend Jason Taylor, relive the greatest moments in the history of the Miami Dolphins.
learn interesting tidbits you may not have known, and discover activities all Dolphins fans must partake in at some point in their life. Head over to DolphinsTalk.com right now to purchase your copy of 100 Things Dolphins Fans Should Know and Do Before They Die today. Remember to use the promo code DolphinsTalk to save 25% off the price. That promo code again is all one word, DolphinsTalk, DolphinsTalk. Thanks for supporting DolphinsTalk.com. Go Dolphins!
Joining me on the DolphinsTalk.com podcast is Jim Florentine, who is a Miami Dolphins super fan and a stand-up comedian. Jim, how are you doing today?
I'm doing good, man. I'm doing even better because your rant yesterday against the city of Buffalo and the coach was phenomenal.
You like that?
The way you ended the podcast, just screaming, and then it ended. I love that.
Yeah, well, my favorite. I mean, at the end of a show, when you have a rant like that, you really can't, you know, say, follow me here on Twitter, check out our Facebook page, go to the website. It's not a time for plugs, but that coach of the Bills, really. I mean, this guy crying and whining, there's going to be 13,000 fans in a stadium in the middle of a pandemic. I mean, get over it, really. Just be happy that they're going to have any games at all. And don't worry about how many fans are in any type of venue. It's dumb.
No, it is. It totally. When I saw that, I thought he was being a baby about it too. But it was a phenomenal rant.
I'm glad you enjoyed that.
Oh yeah, I love. I'm going to listen to it again. It was so great.
Yeah. I mean, it's crazy. Speaking about the virus and speaking about COVID, how are things with you? How are you handling that? I know you're a guy who's usually on the road a lot, always working a bunch of shows, and you. I would assume with this, you probably haven't been on the road much at all for the past, I don't know, five or six months, right?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm doing a few outdoor shows here and there, you know, in New Jersey, New York, Pennsylvania area. But other than that, you know, when it's cold, no one's going to want to be outside. So yeah. I got a couple months of doing shows here and there. But yeah, we're pretty much shut down for a while. So just, you know, do my podcast and, you know, I just wait for it to open again at some point.
Yeah, I was on your website looking. Is that up to date with the one show on October 17th in Syracuse, New York?
We're trying. It depends if they open the venue. Like,
yeah,
it might be. So we're going to know probably like in another week if it's good or not.
I'm in Syracuse, so if you're coming, I will be there because I haven't seen you yet live in person. It seems like we always miss. Sometimes when you're up here, I'm down in Miami, and then a few times when I've been in Miami for a game, you've been there, but not the same week I'm there. So if you are here in Syracuse October 17th, I will come see you because really there's not much going on right now. Everything is closed down. I can't go to any of the football games this year because there's no fans up here for tar games inside of the ACC. So I hope you hold that show and they will let you hold it. Cause I will be there.
Yeah. Well, that'd be great. And I'm, you know, now that the Dolphins announced they're going to have some fans, me and my brother always go down there for games. So I think I'm going to hit a couple of games at some point this year. I'm not sure which ones.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, having some fans in the stadium, let's start with it. I think it's a great thing. Obviously, that'll change in time. There's a possibility they could let more fans in if the numbers in that region continue to stay low. But obviously, if that will increase, I think they'll probably reduce the number of fans in the stadium. It's so fluid with this whole thing. It's crazy. But I think having some fans in the stadium at Hard Rock Stadium is a great thing.
Definitely. It's a good sign. It's a good sign for any teams that are going to have it. I think there's like six now that will have fans for now. So, no, I'll be good. And, you know, I always enjoy going to the games. I want to go to games when Tua's playing.
Exactly. And that was my first question for you. What are your thoughts on Tua now as a member of the Miami Dolphins? I'm sure you're super excited about this like all fans are.
Last year was probably the worst year of my life being a Miami Dolphin fan.
Sucks.
Rooting against them to lose so they can get to with the number one pick. And he gets hurt. And then they keep winning these meaningless games against the Eagles. I mean, I was happy that they beat New England at the end. But even that game, I'm like, why are they winning this? I just want them to play close and lose at the end. Just so we did everything just to get to it. And then we wound up getting them at the number five, which was unbelievable. It was like the best thing that's happened in 2020 for me is that the Dolphins got to it. Now, you know, let them sit. I want them in by like week five or six. I would hope. I don't want them to sit for the whole year, but I think by week, the problem is this is what's going to happen with Miami. They're going to start off 5-1. Fitzpatrick's going to be leading the league in passer ratings, touchdowns, no interceptions, and then they're going to go, we can't put two in now.
Yeah, absolutely. It's going to be that false hope. Fitzpatrick will start, start off the year red hot, and everyone's thinking, okay, he's our guy. We got a chance. And then you know they're going to lose three or four in a row, and it's like, we should have been playing the kid during that stretch.
Just like we should have put Josh Rosen in at some point last year.
Nothing to lose. And I feel a lot for Rosen because he's been in two rough spots, obviously. First with Arizona, and then last year on that Miami roster, which was just so bad. I would like to see him get a chance. It's not going to be with Miami now, I don't think. So I think his time here is probably numbered. But he's got a rough break. But when it comes to the kid quarterback that they took here at number five, I think you're right. I think come October-ish, obviously it all depends on their record. If they are 5-1 or something, no, he's not going to get on the field. But I think, you know, Fitzpatrick is Ryan Fitzpatrick. We know who he is. He's never going to change. He'll have one or two games where he looks outstanding, then one or two games where he couldn't hit the broadside of a barn. And I think once he hits that stretch where he's not looking so good, that's when they're going to slide this kid into the lineup. And I think once he gets in, you can't take him out no matter what. He's your guy moving forward.
Yeah, and it looks like, I mean, the way they're saying in practice, he's moving around. He doesn't seem like there's any effects from the hip injury, which is great. So, but look, obviously you don't want him starting week one. I mean, I think it's too soon to put him in. So let him, you know, sit for 4 or 5 weeks and then put him in around week six. And look, I'm just hoping for 8-8 Miami this year. That'd be great for me. That'd be a good season, you know, to finish like that. I don't need them to tank again. Obviously, I want to start rooting from the win, but, you know, Tua needs to be in by week six.
Yeah, and I think a big part of that sort of ties in with the offensive line, and they have, thank God, a whole new offensive line pretty much because that offensive line has been a mess for so long and so many years, and, you know, they got three young rookies that they picked in this year's draft. I don't think they're all going to start right off the bat, but I think two of them will start per all the reports that we're hearing. And obviously they signed Eric Flowers out of Washington, Ted Karras out of New England. What are your thoughts on the offensive line, some of the young guys there? And hopefully we got this thing finally fixed, or at least moving in the right area to being fixed.
I love that they drafted a bunch of offensive linemen and signed guys. Eric Flowers, I don't know. You know, he had that one good year and he was a bust with the Giants, so I'm not sure how he's going to play. But just that they went draft heavy with the offensive line was great. They needed to do that. They finally, you know, just made all their picks on it. Maybe you could have taken a receiver instead of an offensive lineman, but, you know, I'm happy with what they did with the offensive line. Let's see if these guys work out, but they needed to completely overhaul it.
Yes, absolutely. They had to overhaul, and they put a lot of, you know, an investment into that unit, and hopefully it starts to pay off. It might be a rocky road, though, in September with those guys having so many new pieces and no preseason game. So I think holding off on the young kid at quarterback is wise just for that. But once they sort of gel as a unit and they sort of get their roles all set, I think we'll be good. And I think we got to watch out here for the kid from Georgia that they got in round four, Solomon Kinley, who from all the reports down there is just having an outstanding training camp at right guard. You know, for a pick in round four, that would be a find if he can be someone who is on that offensive line week one in the lineup.
Yeah, well, that's typical Miami. The fourth rounder will be amazing, and the first rounder will be a bust.
I know.
That's what's going to happen.
That's so Dolphins. Yes, absolutely. Yep. And the other name that they took in round one, Noah Igbunogene, which is a name. People get mad because I'm saying it wrong. I'm like, guys, his last name isn't Smith or Jones. It's a tough name to say. It'll probably take me half the year to learn how to say that name right. No, you know what Miami did now at cornerback, assuming Xavier Howard's back, they got Noah, and obviously they signed Jones in the offseason there. What are your thoughts on their secondary overall and how now they have a strength at the cornerback spot?
I like it. I mean, Xavier Howard, I don't know what's going on to him. He's still having knee injuries. And, you know, so I went when they took Noah at first, I was like, I don't know, when, you know, that pick at that spot. But I it's looking good now because, you know, he's not even practicing yet. You know, so, you know, so I like it. Look, and they stocked up on the defense. They signed, you know, Lawson from Buffalo and, you know, Van Noy and stuff. So I like all the moves they made this offseason. You know, and they didn't, they overpaid for, I'm forgetting who they, oh, for Noah. No, whatever, the guy from the Eagles, Jones?
Oh, Jordan Howard?
No, who was the cornerback that they got? Oh, from Dallas, I'm sorry, from the Cowboys. Yeah.
Jones from Dallas, they made him the highest paid cornerback in the league, and they broke the bank for Byron Jones. That was a little bit of a surprise, but I think, now, hindsight, looking back, they might have known more about Howard's knee than they let on. So maybe that move made sense in that they didn't know what was going on with Howard, his knee, when he might be ready. So they wanted to make sure they had someone who was a proven cornerback ready to go. Because with Howard, you know, he had a weird offseason off the field with some issues. This knee injury sort of been lingering now for a few years. There's a lot of question marks with Howard.
Yeah, there is. You know, we'll see. I mean, look, I'm high on this coaching staff. Just what Flores did last year with that team, signing guys off the street. I loved how the defense was playing man to man. They were all over everybody. I mean, some of the games they got blown out, but I'd never even heard of these guys, and they're playing man to man and following these guys down the field and playing like Pro Bowl cornerbacks at safeties. I was like, you know, so that was encouraging for me to see.
Yeah, absolutely. I think with this staff, the one thing they showed last year is they will get the most out of everybody. They squeezed every bit of talent week to week out of what they had. And it wasn't that they had a lot because as you said, they picked someone up on a Monday and he'd be in the starting lineup come the next Sunday. And you never heard of him. You didn't know where he came from. And PB out there making plays. Some weeks, sure, they lost. But some weeks, those final eight games, they won five of them, and they found a way to beat some teams that were pretty good. And, you know, it's like, how are they doing this? Smoke and mirrors. So I'm very high on this coaching staff. I think they know what they're doing. And you know, it's probably been since Jimmy Johnson, which is, you know, almost 20 years now. I mean, it's been a long time since we had a coaching staff where we can say they know what they're, you know, I have faith in them where I don't have to question every move that is being made.
Yeah. Pretty much, yeah. It's been since Jimmy Johnson. You definitely know Dave Wanstead and Philbin and all those clowns.
No. Oh, my God.
Yeah. It was just a nightmare. But I'm excited. You know, it's weird. I never thought I'd say I miss preseason, but I really do.
Me too.
Like I'm not totally into it yet because there's no preseason.
Yep. I'm the same way. It's odd because you sort of watch those games, but really not really pay like a lot of attention to them. But when they're not there, it's like week one, it's just going to be so odd in that, okay, this is a real game. It counts. I haven't seen them yet on the field at all. It's just going to feel odd, I think, week one. That is going to be an interesting feeling, I think.
Yeah, I mean, because we could have saw Tua play, you know, would he been playing in game two, three, four, you know, and then – you know, you see the starters play three quarters in the third game, so you're not seeing any of that. So you're going in basically week one with you have no idea what's going to happen with either team. We don't know how good New England is going to be without Brady, and we don't know how good Miami is going to be with, you know, overhauling three quarters of the team. We have no idea.
Yeah, and you look around the AFC East, and it's not the same AFC East anymore. You got the Patriots. Tom Brady's gone, finally, thank God, and they lost a lot of other guys as well who were major contributors on that team. You got the Jets, obviously. We know about their head coach. He's already making waves down there, which aren't good waves, and they lost Adams. He's gone. You know, probably their only, I would say, superstar player. Then you got the Bills, my favorite team. They actually, you know, as much as I joked about them yesterday, their team on paper right now looks pretty good. I think some people think they're great. I don't know if they're great, but they're probably on paper the best team in the AFC East. What are your thoughts on the AFC East as we head into this year now?
You know, every year you think this is no way New England. You needed Brady and Belichick gone. Well, one of them's still there, so I still think somehow New England wins that division. You know, Cam Newton all of a sudden is going to be a superstar again.
One shot.
He's going to come in. He's going to come in and he's going to be amazing in that system. And, you know, Brady, Belichick's, you know, they had six guys, you know, opt out of the season because of the coronavirus, the Patriots. So, but you know what Belichick's going to do with the waiver wire. I think the last cuts, he's going to pick up six guys and they're going to be amazing. He's going to plug them in and they're going to go 10-6.
Absolutely.
And at least make the playoffs. So I don't know. You know, every time you count Buffalo in, when you think Buffalo, oh, they're the team this year, they always falter.
Yep.
Every time, you know, that they have that curse. Same with the Jets. Whenever the Jets got this buzz that they're going to be good, they never are. So I still think that, you know, probably New England 10-6, Bills 9-7, Miami 8-8, Jets 5-11.
Yeah, I'm right there with you on the Jets. I think they're a hot mess. I just don't see a lot with the Jets. There's nobody on that team where I'm like, wow, they're really good. I just think they're a team, just a run-of-the-mill team. With the Patriots, you know, I know this past week the line came out for the week one game. It was New England as a 6.5-point favorite. And I saw a lot of fans of the Dolphins like, oh, my God, I can't believe it. Guys, you give that head coach an entire offseason to get ready for one game week one, he's going to be ready. I don't care who his roster is. He will be ready for week one. They might come out with a whole new offensive something. They're going to have something ready for Miami week one, especially how their final game sort of how it happened last year where they lost at home to Miami. They're going to be ready for week one. I wouldn't count the Patriots out. Not until I see it. Now, look, if they start off the year 1-6, put the nail in the coffin, they're dead. But I don't think that's going to happen, though. I think I'm a little worried about the Patriots. And then you got the Bills, who I'm with you. Until I actually see it with them, I'm not all there yet. And all joking aside, you know, they crumbled in the playoffs last year in that game against Houston. They crumbled where they had the game won. And I don't know if they're sort of ready for prime time yet. So AFC East is wide open. I think you're sort of right there, how you see it all sort of happening. I think Miami will be in the mix, though.
They got a tough schedule. They definitely do.
Oh,
but
yeah.
This is a weird year, so you never know what's going to happen.
Yep. It's going to be about who stays healthy.
Right. And then also, you know, a quarterback could get coronavirus on Thursday and he can't play for 2 weeks and then Miami doesn't have to face him. So you never know. Like, it's not going to be that weird of a year. So, look, I'm hoping if they go 8-8 and two will go. Gets in the last half of the year and looks solid, then I'm super happy. And they got more picks next year and more money to spend. And hopefully this coronavirus will be gone and everyone go back to the stadiums. So 2021 is what I'm looking forward to, you know, if it goes like that for Miami this year.
Yeah, absolutely. I think 2021 is the year because they will have two more picks in round one next year, two more picks in round two next year, and still a whole bunch of money to spend in the offseason. They will be able, I think, to put sort of the finishing touches on how they want this team to be built and sort of add the pieces that they don't have right now. Because, look, it's a big leap they've made from what they were last year, where they had almost nothing, to where they are now, where they sort of got some units on the side of the ball that look pretty good. I think they're pretty deep at linebacker. I think they're pretty deep in the secondary. I think running back looks okay, you know, and obviously at quarterback, they got a lot of depth. So if someone, and that's where I think they have a small edge over some teams, Miami, where if they were to lose a quarterback, say on a Thursday or Friday for an upcoming game, they got a few guys on the bench who can actually play, where a lot of teams don't have that.
Absolutely. They got a lot. Who would have thought? What season? When was the last time we said that Miami has depth at linebacker and defensive backs and safeties?
Long time.
Yeah, late 90s, maybe, the Wanstead defense that Jimmy gave him. I think that's when it last was. So, I mean, that's amazing that we have that. So, and yeah, the running back position is good. Receiver, I'm not sure. I mean, it sucks that Albert Wilson didn't, you know, opted out this year, you know, because I think he would have been great in the slot. I think he, you know, when he's healthy, the guy's amazing. Looking back at that now, it doesn't look like it was that good of a signing. We're hoping for better from him. You know, he got hurt and then all this other stuff. I thought he was going to have a big year this year if he would have played. So that one definitely hurts.
Yeah, wide receiver is a need. I think next offseason, because they need a little bit more there than what they got. I think what they got with Parker and Williams is really good. But after that, there's a lot of question marks. But I think they'll be okay there this year. But that is one spot where if someone were to get hurt, they might be in a little bit of trouble. Speaking of which, what guy on this roster, because last year we saw it with Parker, how he had been, you know, not a great player up until last year. Then he, boom, big year. And just he exploded onto the scene. Which player on this roster do you think could be that guy this year, that big guy who sort of breaks out and makes a name for himself?
That's interesting. You know, Gesicki had a great year last year, you know, which you thought he after did. The first year, like, oh, man, that's another bust, which, you know.
Yep.
But he came along, and then Devontae Parker, we couldn't believe that they even kept him. Like, why did they know something about him that we don't? Because we didn't see anything for 3 years, and he came along. You know, that Van Ginkle guy on defense, you know, he came in late in the year. He was hurt early. I liked him a lot. He had a lot of energy running around. He reminded me like Zach Thomas with long hair, the way he played. So I'm hoping he just becomes a force there, especially he's got some players around him. So that's the guy I think I'm looking at.
Yeah, he's got a nonstop motor, and he can just go out there. So, yeah, that's actually a wise choice. And I like him a lot, too. I think he's going to be really good. And I think with the injury to Vince – his last name slipping my mind right now, linebacker who got hurt last week, Vince
Beagle.
Yeah, I think with him gone, Andrew Van Ginkle is going to be in that role, and I think he'll be on the field a lot now, and he may even be a guy who starts. So, yeah, absolutely. This is going to be a fun year. Hopefully they can play all 16 games and they can get through it, but it's, you know, probably I've had you on the podcast, I don't know how many times now, Jim, probably 5 times, and it's always been a little bit negative, this, that, and the other. This is the first time where I think your hopes are high, my hopes are high. We don't expect the world this year, but we see that they're headed in the right way, that they're going in the right way, and maybe 2021 is going to be a big year. And this year, at least, you know, they got the pieces in place where it will be fun to watch, and we're not going to be out there rooting for them to lose or just don't embarrass us on national TV. We're actually going to see them win, and it's going to be fun to watch this young team sort of come all together.
And look, this could be the year they win a road game on a Thursday night because they're playing the Jaguars week 3.
Yes, I hope they can win that game.
They haven't won one. I don't think they've ever won one on the road. It's on every year they get it on the road, and they get blown out.
Blown out by the Ravens, blown out by Pittsburgh, blown out by the Panthers. I think they've been blown out more Thursday night games on the road. Cincinnati, I think they, you know, whipped them up. They just lose on those primetime road games. It's like, I didn't want to see that on the schedule anymore.
I know. I went to the Dolphin Raven game 2 years ago when they lost 41-0. I drove from Jersey. It was a 3-hour drive. There was traffic. I got to the stadium midway through the first quarter. I left by the middle of the third quarter because it was 37-0. And I drove 3 hours all the way back home.
That's
miserable.
That's a rough trip. That's a long drive. That's a rough trip. I've made a lot of those trips because I'm up here in Syracuse, obviously. And when they play at the Bills, my favorite town and city, I've made a lot of those drives where that ride home, you're like, why did I just waste my time? Because after they've been blown out, lost, I'm usually sitting outside in the ice cold. It's like, what am I freaking doing? Man, why do I go to these games and put myself through this? So that long drive home, yeah, it's it lets you think for a long time why you do this, why you root for this team. But,
I went to opening day last year when they went to Red, 56-7?
Yes.
Yeah, I flew down for the game. I brought my kid down there. My brother brought his kid. We flew down for the weekend, a bunch of family members. The first play of the game, I think they had like a 10-yard loss or 7-yard loss to defense. I'm like, all right, and we're going crazy. The kickoff was, at the 20, and they got the ball, and it was a 7-yard loss, and that was the only good play of the game.
Yep.
We cheered Lamar once, Jackson. And the next play, the guy ran 72 yards down the
Lamar Jackson went nuts, yeah.
Yeah.
Fun times, Jim, fun times, but hopefully that's all behind
great.
Us.
Yeah.
Hopefully it's behind us, and we have a new day. Jim, thanks so much for a few moments of your time. Everyone, check out the website, Jim, Florentine.com. Jim, I might be seeing you in October if that show is taking place, because I will be there, because I've been locked up inside my house long enough, and I got to get out and I got to do something. So if there's a show in October, I'll come see you for sure. And yes, and you can also
I'll let you know. I'll let you know if it's on. And then, I do my podcast is on Barstool Sports every Monday and Thursday. It's called Everybody is Awful.
Yep, and you got the podcast, and also follow Jim on Twitter at Mr. Jim Florentine. Jim, thanks so much, and we'll talk to you again soon, I'm sure.
Thanks, man.
You have a good one.
All right.
Thank you for listening to the DolphinsTalk.com podcast. Be sure to visit DolphinsTalk.com every day for all of your latest Miami Dolphins news.